I'm Deborah Burton and I run a small organisation called Tipping Point North South, and we work in cinema documentaries, one-off events and single issue campaigning. And this Attlee Remembered Weekend is under something we call Attlee Nation, and it's our newest project, and we are indebted to Sands, these amazing people in this building who just gave us this building for the weekend. And this weekend is special to us. It's the 50th anniversary today of the death of Clement Attlee, and he is way too much in the sidelines, the shadows, than he should be. So in our own little way, we're trying to sort of bridge that gap from the books and the people who really know their Attlee and take it to a wider audience and to build on this weekend. I just want to give a little few words of context in terms of Attlee. And now, so between 1945 and 1951, Attlee's government saw the creation of the National Health Service, we know, the building of 1 million homes, 1,000 new schools, 25,000 teachers, new teachers, the introduction of fair wage and employment conditions, child benefit, disability benefit, social insurance, sickness pay, maternity pay, national parks. And the discovery for me was legal aid. I didn't know that legal aid came in under the Attlee government. That's not to mention the nationalisation, the public ownership programme that took place at the same time, all in 5.5 years. And for us, there's a really important little piece of information out there. In 2004, Maury and Leeds University polled 139 political historians, social historians, to rank in the 20th century the greatest prime minister. And over Churchill, over Thatcher, it was Attlee. And that's been replicated in a number of other times, ran a survey of political historians. So Attlee's up there. Who is he? We have see a little guy puffing on a pipe in the NHS, and that's probably as much as we know about Attlee. We are using this, we've been promoting, because fundamentally for us, this is... Somebody told me last night, I've been quoting Mark Thomas, it's Milan Kundera, quoted by Mark Thomas.
And Kundera's probably quoting someone else.
Who says that, certainly for the left, politics is the battle of remembering over forgetting. And we think there's no kind of bigger tick on that, in a sense, than for Attlee. And we use the blue and white colouring of the Obama, Yes We Can. And we are laying it over Attlee, because what we believe is he said yes we can in 45, and at the end of 5 years he was able to say yes we did, and we are saying and yes we can again. So I'm delighted to discuss today, this afternoon. We want to look at this arc from Hardy through Attlee through to the present day. What is it that they think, our speakers think, make a great Labour leader, and where might Corbyn fit in that? What kind of a leader might he be? So I just want to give a little bit of biog for... Now I'm going to sit down, and this is the test. Can you hear me? So Francis, his book, Clem Attlee, Labour's Great Reformer, is at the heart of this weekend for us. Personally, for me, it's my favourite biography, Attlee biography. What to say? So Francis has written 19 books, biographies of 4 prime ministers. Edited a series of 20 biogs. Is this right? Prime ministers of the 20th century.
Yeah.
Editor of Third Age Matters, has written so many pieces for national newspapers and magazines. Former president of the NUJ, and has also worked as well for trade unions and the Labour Party. Melissa Benn, writer, campaigner. Obviously, you know, her journalism has appeared in numerous magazines and newspapers and magazines, especially The Guardian, on a range of social issues, especially education. She's the founder of the Local Schools Network and chair of Comprehensive Future. Her books include School Wars, The Battle for Britain's Education, One of Us, and What Should We Tell Our Daughters, and is very much advocating now on this National Education Service, which... feels like also an idea's time has come.
Could I just mention that two of those are novels, just because I like to, I've written 2 novels, so they're not all about social issues. And I've just written another novel, so, you know, could get that in.
And a great website too. Rachel, Rachel Holmes is a cultural historian whose work combines meticulous biographical research with an ability to bring the life and times of her 19th century subjects vividly to life. She's the author of the highly acclaimed, you have to read it, Eleanor Marx, A Life, published in 2014, which was described by Golden Pen Award winner Gillian Slovo as a dazzling account of a woman and her family, an age and a movement that grips from the first page to the last. Rachel is currently coming, are you? Oh, yep. This is important. 2010, Rachel received an Arts Council Cultural Leadership Award as one of Britain's 50 women to watch. She's worked for the British Council Literature Festivals and international programmes since 2000, and since 2012 has been the UK chair of the Iraq Literature Festival. She was recently chosen to be one of the writers on the literary tour of the UK Russia Year of Culture, and is currently finishing up a
not
book,
today.
Maybe, not today, on Sylvia Pankhurst. So that's enough from me. I wanted to get Frances to give us a little sort of thumbnail sketch, roll call, a canter through time of Labour leaders so that we can kind of orientate ourselves, and then sort of go back to the beginning and start with Keir Hardie. Melissa's written an awful lot about Keir Hardie, and then come through to Attlee, up to Corbyn. Rachel recently wrote a piece in The Guardian which was covering that span too, and also, and we should give a little bit of time to, as you would call them, the also-rans, all of those others in there who figure. Anyway, over to Frances to kick us off.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm not going to start at Keir Hardie because I'm going to leave that to Melissa, and I'm going to start where Labour becomes the main opposition party and the potential government party. Shall I stand up? Is it going to be easier? Are you going to hear better if I stand up? Through which time, the Labour Party had a number of leaders, all of whom were. There were differences, but there were also similarities between all of them right up until 1994. Mm. And in 1994, Labour elected something fundamentally different as its leader from what it had had, from what it had always had. It had before several leaders who grew pretty disenchanted with what I like to call Labour England, the Labour of the trade unions, the Workers' Educational Association, all of those things. All of its leaders, some of them have become very, very fed up with it. Ramsay MacDonald in particular became very fed up with it. But they all knew it, they understood it, they'd been brought up with it. In 1994, for the very first time, Labour elected a leader who didn't know what it looked like. And that, I think, is at the root of the failure of Tony Blair's 1997 government, that he didn't understand the ground from which his party sprang. But to go back, the first I want to start with is Ramsay MacDonald. Ramsay MacDonald was elected by the left of the Labour Party. The conflict between the left and the right in the Labour Party is kind of endemic to it, and it has been going on all the way through. And the trade unions have variously been condemned by the left for colluding with the right and condemned by the right for colluding with the left. Clement Attlee once said that those who condemn the bloc vote, by which Labour leaders were elected, generally only do so when the bloc vote has been cast against their own favoured candidate. And they're very much in favour of the bloc vote whenever it's cast in favour of, on their side of the argument. MacDonald came out of the left, out of the ILP. Now, the Independent Labour Party at that time, the word independent in ILP meant it was independent of the Liberal Party. Of course, fairly soon in the late 20s, it started sort of tacitly to mean independent of the Labour Party. But at that time, it meant independent of the Liberal Party. And the ILP, MacDonald came out of the ILP and was therefore the candidate of the left, defeating the candidate of the right, J.R. Clines. The left might have been very much happier in the long run had J.R. Clines won. But these things happened. Ramsay MacDonald, as we all know, disappeared in a cloud of dust in 1931, and was never heard of again. He was prime minister for another 4 or 5 years, but But he, so far as the Labour Party was concerned, he was dead. He was finished. He was somebody. He was like the black sheep of the family. You never really talk about it. You never confess that you knew him. There was a period of Labour in opposition. It was led very briefly by Arthur Henderson, but he lost his seat in 1931. And then it was led by George Lansbury. George Lansbury, I think the quickest way to sum him up is he's a kind of a Michael Foot figure, really. He was an elderly left winger, a pacifist. He'd been a pacifist during the First World War. And he was, in the end, his downfall was the debate about rearmament. Because he, as a pacifist, couldn't face the idea of rearmament, but there was a growing need in the Labour Party that Hitler, the presence of Hitler in Europe, required Labour to dispense with its anti-war stance. The end for him really came at the 1936 Labour Party conference, where Ernest Bevin, who arrived with several hundred thousand votes in his pocket, said that it is putting the movement in entirely a wrong position for its leader to be wandering around with tarting his conscience. What was the word? Not tarting. Hawking his conscience around the country, asking to be told what to do with it. So that was Clement Attlee's moment. Clement Attlee led Labour into the subsequent general election and, as we know, led Labour for the next 20 years. Now, just pause for a minute to put Attlee in some sort of context and try to dispense with some of the myths that surround him. One of the myths surrounding Attlee was that he was an accidental prime minister, an accidental leader, an accidental prime minister. It ought never to have happened. Actually, he was the least accidental leader and prime minister almost that we've ever had. The accidental prime ministers really are Harold Wilson and Tony Blair, because they only became leader of the Labour Party and therefore potentially prime minister because of the early and unexpected death of their respective predecessors, Hugh Gaitskell and John Smith. And had that not happened, then it is quite likely that neither Wilson nor Blair would ever have been prime minister. He was much less accidental prime minister than any of them. Suggested that he was only elected as a stopgap, and that actually what the person they really wanted as leader was Herbert Morrison. Well, this slightly puzzles me, because I think if they'd wanted Herbert Morrison, they would have elected Herbert Morrison. He was a candidate. He was the losing candidate. He came second in the election. There was another candidate, was Arthur Greenwood. And when all the votes were redistributed, Attlee had won really quite substantially. And I think that what the Labour Party at that time wanted was pretty well the exact opposite of Ramsay MacDonald. They had had a leader who made beautiful but fairly meaningless speeches. They'd had all that. They had all that in Ramsay MacDonald, and they wanted something fundamentally different. They'd had a leader who had a travelling salesman's smile, and it was, you know, and we didn't have another one until 1994. But they'd had that sort of leader. They wanted something fundamentally different, and they got something fundamentally different. It's suggested that he couldn't be prime minister now. It wouldn't work for him now. He didn't have the right. And it's certainly true that he didn't really know how to handle television. But he didn't know how to handle television because he didn't need to. At first, he didn't know how to handle radio. But he learned how to handle radio, and he learned to be very, very good on radio because he needed to learn that. In his time, he didn't really need to learn to be good on television. He could no doubt have handled that, because just in a professional way, you learn the skills that you have to have. I think that the idea that you could never have such a prime minister now rests on the assumption that you've got to have a prime minister or a leader who has the kind of personality that MacDonald had, that Tony Blair had, that is sort of immediate and It is, I can put it no better, it's the sort of personality that you would expect a travelling salesman to have. You would expect somebody who came to your door trying to sell you something to have a kind of immediate...
Rachel said, sell you something you don't want.
No, sell you something you don't want. Yeah, well, as a matter of fact, yes, that's exactly right, isn't it? So, I I think the other great myth about him, I think, is that he was actually, Churchill is supposed to have said he was a modest little man with plenty to be modest about. He was actually the most immodest person that you can possibly imagine. Far more immodest than somebody who feels the need to talk all the time and to explain everything all the time. He rather despised people who needed to talk all the time. Instead of Hugh Dalton, you know, he would talk, silly fellow. And so fired him. Hugh Dalton had given away his budget secrets to a journalist on his way into deliver his budget. And when somebody came to tell the Prime Minister and said, what's he done? Well, Prime Minister, he spoke to a journalist. He spoke to a journalist. What on earth would he want to do that for? And I mean, he genuinely couldn't understand how somebody would want to, when they were going about some serious business, would want to stop and talk to a journalist. Herbert Morrison said of him, he came down to Chequers to stay with him. And Herbert Morrison was the sort of politician who woke up every morning and feverishly studied the papers and instantly fired off complaints to editors about the things that he didn't agree with. And he arrived at Chequers mid-morning Sunday, and he said, well, you've seen the Sunday morning papers, and that, he said, no, never read the Sunday papers. And Herbert said, I never know whether to take him seriously or not. But it was true. He didn't bother to read the Sunday papers. He read the Daily Herald to see what the Labour Party was doing. He read the Times. Well, he did. I don't think he actually read the Times. He did the Times crossword every morning, but that was about the level of his acquaintanceship with the papers, with the newspapers. He kept up. There's a nice story about his chief spin doctor, Francis Williams. They didn't call him spin doctor. I think he was just called chief press officer or something, and. Francis Williams wanted to have a telex machine in the office so that he could find out what was running on the Press Association tapes. And he said, he went to ask the Prime Minister if he could have this machine, and the Prime Minister said, can't see any use for it. And Francis Williams, who knew his man, said, well, the thing about it is, Prime Minister, you'll be able to get the score from Lords on this machine as it's playing. And he said, that's fine. We'll have one then. And one day he put his head round Francis Williams' door and said, Francis, that's my cricket machine. It's giving out all the decisions we made in Cabinet this morning. How can it do that? And he had no idea that every lunchtime after Cabinet, Francis Williams would routinely brief the political correspondents, and that that what had been done that morning was. And so Francis Williams sort of explained this and actually thought for a minute that, all right then, Francis, leave it with you. And he went off and never asked again. So that was. So I paused a minute on Attlee, but Attlee was succeeded briefly by Hugh Gaitskell. Harold Wilson was a different sort of Labour leader. He was Harold Wilson had enormous but terribly obvious political skills, so that he became known. He became thought of as a political fixer. Attlee was just as much of a political fixer as Wilson, but he didn't talk about it so much. And so nobody actually sort of thought of Attlee as having these Machiavellian skills. And actually, Machiavellian skills are probably best not talked of too much. They're probably most effective that way. So that Harold Wilson, I think, quite unjustly got himself as a reputation as a double dealer and a twister. And those of you of a certain age will remember the joke that we used to make about Harold Wilson. What are the two worst things about Harold Wilson? His face. It was a grotesquely unfair joke, but I'm looking around the room. At least some of you are old enough to remember that one. But thank you. So Wilson to Callaghan. Now Callaghan. Is thought of as a right-wing prime minister, but Callaghan was steeped in what I call Labour England, mm-hmm. in a way that very few Labour leaders have been, absolutely steeped in it. He came out of the trade unions. He was self-taught. He felt himself to be to have sprung up from that and to owe everything to that in a way that no other Labour leader did. Attlee had found the Labour Party as the solution to a problem. Wilson had grown up in it, but grown up in it as a technocrat. For Callaghan, it was the air he breathed. It was everything about him. And somebody, I think it was Barbara Castle, said of him that you know all these horrible committee rooms and these Ronio machines and you touch them and you get ink all over you, and then you take all these leaflets out and you distribute them. And she said, Jim likes all that. There was a sort of, there was something, somehow or another, you felt that he represented Labour England in a way that few other leaders had. Callaghan was followed by Michael Foot fairly briefly, and I was a Labour Party press. You mentioned I'd been a Labour Party press officer. Am I going on too long? Should I stop?
No, this is interesting. I'm learning stuff. Definitely carry on.
It appears to be bloody well interesting.
It is bloody interesting.
You know, it's never actually happened to me in the middle.
Mid flow,
the chair says, "Is this interesting, Francis?"
Please carry on. Yeah.
Well, I'll try. Yes. I was a Labour Party press officer during the 1983 general election. I'm fine now. I've made it complete. I still wake up at night screaming, obviously. But it was. I remember the election. One of the things that I remember about it, and not entirely because of the way the press behaved, although very largely, is how desperately unfair it was, because Michael Foot. People talk to Michael Foot as a weak leader. I mean, if you stood with him, if you listened to him take decisions, if you understood what he was doing, he was very strong and very courageous and knew exactly what he wanted. He was maybe a bit too collegiate. I know that that there was a huge meeting in his room every morning. Dozens and dozens of people kept walking into this room, and the press officers would stand outside and say, "What is that? What's he doing here?" And some minor trade union official would walk through me and say, "Why is he here?" But you never. Apparently, ages and ages, there was somebody sitting in the room for the first week of the election, and nobody knew who it was. And eventually, somebody said, "Who are you?" And it turns out he was the secret. He was the Secret Service man assigned to protect Michael Foot and make sure that he wasn't assassinated. And he came in and he sat in the room, and because there were so many people there, nobody actually worked out who the hell he was. So quite apart from it being a very difficult election, it was also an extraordinarily badly run election. And there is a Labour Party campaign song that was commissioned by the Labour Party, and when it came into the press office, we listened to it once, and then we suppressed it. We had all copies destroyed, and only 6 copies remained. And I now have the only one extant, because 3 of them are dead, and the other 2 lost their copy. So I put it on my computer and sent it to both of them. But no, you can't have it. It's utterly dreadful. It begins, "Rebuild Britain, Labour leads the way to a glorious tomorrow." It's just a song that could only have been commissioned by a campaign with a death wish. Anyway, all the rest is within our lifetimes, and I won't go into it. Just for a moment. And this will be the last thing that I want to do now, is people ask me sometimes, is Jeremy Corbyn a Clem Attlee figure?
No,
he isn't. He isn't a Clem Attlee. That doesn't mean that we can't hope that he's not going to run a government that could end up perhaps with the same sort of record of achievement as Clem Attlee's government. If you think that 70 is the new 60, he'll be about the right age to do it by the time he becomes prime minister, and there are some things about his personality that are the same as Attlee's. Well, I mean, he's not a very good public speaker. I suppose that helps, but his whole political style and his whole political life is the exact opposite of what Clem Attlee's was. If you put Jeremy Corbyn in Clem Attlee's timeline, Jeremy Corbyn was a rebel in the ILP rebel in the 1920s. In the 1930s, he would probably have joined the Communist Party, and if he didn't, he would have joined the Socialist League. He would have been a Benite in the 50s. Bevanite. He would have been a Bevanite in the 50s, and was a Bevanite in the 50s. So, if you put Attlee into Jeremy Corbyn's timeline, he would have been an enthusiastic supporter of Neil Kinnock and John Smith. He would have tolerated Tony Blair. He would have wanted a place in Tony Blair's cabinet, just as he wanted a place in Ramsay MacDonald's cabinet. He would have kept a low profile and hoped for the chance to achieve something later on. So they're fundamentally different people with fundamentally different political styles. And you know, all the sort of excitable stuff about how we've got a new Clem Attlee on our hands, all that I'm afraid is so much rubbish, but that doesn't mean that if he becomes Prime Minister, what he has in common with Clem Attlee is a clarity of purpose. What he wants to achieve, why he is in politics, and I suppose it's the difference between somebody who is in politics to be something and somebody who is in politics to do something. Mm. And what he has in common with Clem Attlee is that he is not in politics to be something, but he seems to me to be somebody who is in politics in order to do something. Thank you.
Makes me want to go and read about Jim Callaghan. So I want to go back, really. We're talking about what is it that makes a great Labour leader? I want to talk a little bit about Keir Hardie, and I've got a little great quote here that Clem Attlee, 1956, this is from one of your pieces on Clem Attlee, 1956, there was a statue of Keir Hardie placed in the House of Commons, and Attlee said, "Mr. Speaker, I think this is the first time that a bust has been placed in the House of Commons of a member of the working class. Hardie was not only born of the working class, he remained of the working class." And Attlee added, you say, "Few members of Parliament had a greater effect upon the House of Commons than Keir Hardie."
Okay, discuss. Yeah, I have not prepared a peroration,
no,
but I will make a few comments. A few thoughts arising from what Francis said. It was very interesting. I know why you did. You started with Ramsay MacDonald, who actually, in a way, is the absolute antithesis of what we're generally looking at in Labour leaders. Then, as you were talking, I was thinking about the differences and connections between Keir Hardie, Attlee, and Jeremy Corbyn. I think you're absolutely right that I think what unites them all is a moral purpose. And being in politics for what I would call the right, or the left in their case, reasons. I think what's absolutely true, though, is that Attlee was a fixer, not of a Wilson Callaghan kind, but he was an intensely pragmatic man who also, and I think we have to say this before I go back to Keir Hardie, I think the significance of Attlee, you can't look at his premiership without taking into account the Second World War. You know, somebody has said now about Jeremy Corbyn and what kind of a Prime Minister he would be, that one of the things that will go against, that will make it hard for him, is that usually if you want to make major change, it either follows the collapse of the state, violent revolution, a world war, and I've forgotten what, a pandemic.
A spread of diseases. You know, so in other words, emergencies help foster radicalism. And I think that Attlee is very interesting
because he was that sort of pragmatic, minimalist man coming at a time of national emergency, and that created an alchemy that then created the 45 to 51 government. But if we go back to Keir Hardie, who I've become very interested in and is was certainly not recognised and celebrated during my early lifetime as a young adult, the sort of Blair, Kinnock Blair period. I mean, Hardy would have been completely forgotten and seen as a relic of the past. And there is something about Hardy where I think, and I would say this of all, when we talk about all these leaders, they are all a product of their moment. I mean, I know it's an obvious thing to say, and you say that people aren't accidental. I think all politicians, actually, their careers are accidental. You know, Attlee himself only became leader because some of the big beasts that he worked so well with and managed to contain lost their seats in the 31 election.
No,
well, you wouldn't. Well, anyway, that's what John Bew says. That you can, you know.
Yeah, I know. I think you're wrong.
Okay, but
about so much.
Sorry. But you know, I mean, Jeremy Corbyn. I was just reading today about, you know, John McDonnell standing for the leadership, Diane Abbott standing, never getting anywhere. Jeremy Corbyn got there. Now, of course, he got there because he was at the right. He was a lightning rod for movements outside that needed to be expressed. But there's always an element of accident in politics. You know, you're the right person at the right time. But Keir Hardie was a figure of the 19th century. I mean, if you look at, when I remember when I started looking at pictures of him, he looks so fundamentally different. Mm. I mean, even Ramsay MacDonald looks a bit more modern. Keir Hardie, you know, when he first went to the House of Commons, he wore his deerstalker that went actually with the suit he was wearing. But he was absolutely mocked for this kind of old-fashioned costume. But he, more importantly than that, he came from the working class. He had been to work at the age of six. He worked from the age of six onwards. He saw his, you know, his family not have enough to eat. He saw his stepfather out of work. He had been down the mines in his teens, and he had this burning sense of injustice about class conflict. And his historic purpose, which he undoubtedly fulfilled, was to separate the growing trade unions, the craft unions and the new unionism of the 1880s from the Liberal Party and from liberal individualism. And his great achievement was, although I think he was a great idealist, and in that sense I think he is quite similar to Corbyn, an agitator, an idealist, never happier than when speaking to a crowd. And interestingly, actually, he went abroad often, a bit like Charles Dickens, actually. Mm. And he would go and speak in Canada and in India, and he was a great internationalist. I'm not sure if Jeremy Corbyn does that, actually. I thought we ought to suggest to Jeremy Corbyn, he's got enough to do at the moment, but that, see whether his speaking skills, which I think you slightly underestimate, but he's very good with a crowd. But what Hardy was, an idealist and an agitator who was also a great pragmatist. He brought together those middle-class socialists and the trade union movement into the 1893, the formation, well, the ILP he was part of the formation of, then the Labour Representation Committee, and then the Labour Party in Parliament. He was the leader of the Labour Party in Parliament for one disastrous year, 1906 to 1907. And I remember when Jeremy Corbyn was about to be elected, and I did write a piece for The Guardian about this, and I'm interested when I reread it. And I used the term, if Jeremy Corbyn were to be elected, which of course makes me look very sort of, you know, this was in the August when nobody knew. I recognised, and I think rightly so, that just what was ahead for a man of his, you know, in a way, because of his connection to Bennism, which I think fair to say I grew up with in every sense, and because I, you know, knew him from a sort of a young man, so he was always very quiet. Person, somebody said he wasn't a great leader, he was just at everything, which sounds a bit disparaging, but Jeremy just, he's endured. I thought, my God, what's going to happen if he becomes leader of the Labour Party? And I think it's fascinating what has happened. I mean, I feel I've lived through the last 2 years for reasons that have, you know, quite complicated and, well, probably fairly obvious. And how, you know, I've just hated every moment of it in one way. But I think what Jeremy has learnt, and here I think, here I think he's a bit like Clement Attlee. Clement Attlee knew that he had to bring the talents together. Mm. So he drew in Dalton and Cripps and balanced them with Bevin and Morrison and so on. But he did that at the cabinet table. I think what Jeremy has learned to do is to find two sets of balance. Well, he's done many things, but he obviously, because of the 30 years of being in the campaign group and being utterly marginalised in the Labour Party. I mean, they were so marginalised, it's, you know, we all know that. But there's a great bond there. So when people talk about McDonald would really like to be the leader or Diana, but I think there's a connection born of those 30 years in the political wilderness that will serve them well should they get to government. But I think the other thing Jeremy's done is surround himself with a very good team. So people talk about Lotto, which sounds like a game, but the leader of the opposition's office, and I have it on good understanding, I have no reason to think this isn't true, there are five or six key people who are shaping the Corbyn project. Andrew Fisher, who wrote the manifesto, Seamus Milne, formerly of The Guardian, John Trickett, who's a sort of parliamentary person, Carrie Murphy, and one other, I can't remember who it is, I'm sorry to leave them out. But I think the point about that is that Jeremy recognises his own, let's not say weaknesses, he recognises what he's good at, and the election showed what he's good at. And I actually think what's interesting about him as well is he's very good on television. And this is where the Ed Miliband, who I have a huge affection for, wouldn't call an also ran, because I think Ed did really important things for the party. But Ed froze at that final summit, you know, and who can blame anyone? You know, if, you know, I remember seeing Jeremy go out and do that question time scary thing where they put them out in the question time audience, but it's just them on their own. And he was brilliant. And I think there's two reasons for that. He is secure in his own skin. And also that 30 years of knowing what he thinks. And then that connects. I'm not talking enough about Keir Hardie. I'm really sorry, because I've just been thinking about all of this. But, you know, there's in politics, and I think this is something Ed Miliband suffered from, experience helps, wherever you get that experience from. Really believing something helps. Really having principle, which Hardie had, absolute moral basis to his socialism, mixing it with enough pragmatism. So I think his achievement was the formation of the Labour Party, not the leading of it in Parliament. Two other things about Keir Hardie which do relate to later leaders. His commitment, and I'm sure Rachel can talk about this more as she's doing the biography of Sylvia, but his commitment to women's suffrage, which actually was a lot more complicated than it sounds, because at the time the Labour movement was riven between those who, using the argument about universal adult suffrage, did not want to support the Pankhursts, and the Pankhursts who wanted a limited bill because they wanted equality of the suffrage, you know, so in a way that the middle class, the property classes, men and women should have it. And I think actually it's to Keir Hardie's real credit that he picked his way through that morass, and I think he did the right thing. I mean, in the end the Pankhursts rejected him. In the end, his insistence on supporting the limited bill alienated from the Labour Party at the time. But I think he showed principle in his feminism. He wasn't, George Lansbury was understood feminism better. He understood, he anticipated, this is not a sentence you'll hear often, he anticipated second wave feminism in the connection between the personal and the political. Keir Hardie did not. My mother wrote a biography of Keir Hardie, and I lived with through the 7 years of her writing that. It's a very good book. And she was very interested, probably because of her own experience of having been married to a not a Labour leader, but a Labour figure, of the personal cost of politics. And she writes very interestingly about Keir Hardie's family. And of course, Keir Hardie had a relationship of a sort with Sylvia Pankhurst. So that was the second thing about Keir Hardie, his commitment to suffrage. The third, which I think did for him in terms of the establishment, well, two things. One, his anti-monarchism. And again, I find this riveting, connecting it up with Corbyn. You see, and I think Jeremy's more of a pragmatist, actually, than Keir Hardie. Because when Jeremy Paxman asked Jeremy Corbyn in the last election, I thought it was the most hilarious moment that told against Jeremy Paxman, where Jeremy Paxman went, there's nothing about the monarchy in this manifesto. You haven't said anything about the monarchy. And Jeremy Corbyn said, in a very relaxed way, well, that's because we're not going to do anything about the monarchy. And the audience absolutely laughed. And on the monarchy, on Trident, and to a certain extent on grammar schools, which I have been campaigning to get the Labour Party to be committed to a fully comprehensive system. In short, the argument coming from certain wings of Corbynism is we don't want to waste political capital on that fight they don't think is important enough. So I think there's a lot of pragmatism at the heart of Corbynism. But the pacifism of Keir Hardie, you know, he died at the beginning of the First World War a broken man. I mean, he partly because of his childhood and the rigours of his life, he was very unwell for a lot of his life, and he just spent his adulthood going and speaking at public meetings, which I think gives you an enormous amount of adrenaline and gives you a real boost, but it's quite exhausting. But he was against the Boer War, which he saw, as somebody brilliantly put it, it was a struggle between two burglars, you know, the Dutch and the English. He was very against the First World War. And of course, the price you paid for that. I remember my grandfather, who was against the Boer War, you know, and we would hear stories about, you go and speak at a meeting and people would just break it up. You know, there would be people with flags, and Hardy was spat at. Once he went home to Scotland, and his daughter, who was very devoted, wanted to walk back with him to the station, and he said, I don't want you to, because he knew people might spit at him and attack him. And I think those experiences, you know, the price that the children of politicians pay, I think is underestimated. Now, why did I say that sentence? That was not very but I think probably I feel that very profoundly. Yeah. For some reason or other. So
we'll try and work it out.
Yes, I think that's right. I think a psychotherapist could do that in about 25 seconds, as I have in fact myself done. But anyway, I was very sympathetic to, but Hardy protecting his children from that. I'm just saying he was very morally brave. And in fact, Hugh Dalton became a socialist the night he saw Hardy go and speak. I can't remember if it was Oxford or Cambridge, but where a lot of young, sort of well-off, probably Boris Johnson types, abused him and shouted him. And when Dalton saw Hardy, he said he spoke without fear or anger, and I became a socialist that night. And that was really impressive. So I think I've covered the main
Thank
things
you.
About
yeah,
him.
Fascinating.
Yeah. So much, yes.
I was just picking up on that and just responding. I was struck in one of the places where you started, Melissa, about which I agree with, that sense of or the reality, the pragmatic reality of a moment of crisis.
Yeah.
And for precisely the reason, and you would, when you were looking at those moments, so there's the Hardy and then the Attlee, that Attlee post-war moment, and then now, in relation to Corbyn. And I think as we sit here reflecting on the fact, let's remember what the membership figures of the Labour Party were just a few years ago, and then let's think about what they are now, not only as the, you know, what is it, roughly about 600,000?
600,000,
you know.
Yeah.
But just thinking about where the fortunes of the party stand at the moment, but I think it is a moment of crisis for all the reasons that
austerity.
You
austerity
yeah so it's austerity. I think the consequences of 2008 2009 we've barely found a language for yet, so this slide and the collapse of the markets and the impact that it's having, the loss of confidence, the very real rise of fascism and the right that is now happening globally. The reality, it is not a reality show, it's not a game show. Trump is real. We can see the rise of different individual fascist extreme right wing movements in Europe as well. But also, as you say, more broadly, austerity, environmental issues on which a lot of these people stood. So I feel that it is precisely because it is a moment of crisis. An epochal moment of crisis, that Corbyn stands in relation to Attlee, not talking about personality, but in relation to that moment. And then another through line, which I think is really interesting in terms of what you were saying there, is the point about feminism and suffrage. And looking back at how important that issue of women's rights, and it was suffrage, it's true, it was the vote, and that became the argument what broke it, but the broader commitment to the rights of women from someone who was was brought up, you know, as a, you know, by a single working mother, who had, you know, who's and all of that that we know, and So what Hardy brought to the foundations, that the way in which the question, the woman question as it was called, but the question of women, the question of feminism, the question of working women and equality was built into those struggles. We're very familiar with saying, yeah, we know that we're in alliance of the trade unions and, you know, and the ILP and, you know, the socialist federations and so on, and we're a broad umbrella. But this idea that that the rights of women and feminism ever stood outside of it, it simply didn't. And we can remind ourselves that in those old days, even when Emmeline Pankhurst was still a socialist, and they were, you know, that they were all together in those earlier phases, and then people went off. So, and I agree with you completely that because Hardy stood and said, I will stand down as leader from the party on this issue of women's enfranchisement. And even if it is a limited bill, which of course looks at the one level, of course, the argument is if you're now get the principle of giving women the vote on the same terms of which men have them, which then of course is a property and a restricted vote, but the argument being, but it's a justice because it's on equal terms. But actually his preparedness, his understanding of how deep this went, and he was so persuaded and constantly Barrett by other leaders and saying, you can't do this. And he's like, no, I can't do anything else. I will go down for this if I have to. And he understood that where women were going to stand in relation to this historical movement was absolutely the centre. Now, Mark, you moved forward to Jeremy Corbyn. What I really responded to, and I was interested in what you were saying, was also that question of self-awareness of where the present and the future lies in relation to the past, but also the skill sets and the people that you surround yourself by. And what we look at and what we see is a shadow cabinet and extended team, which has a powerhouse of talent, of women leaders with different kinds of expertise, and some really credible potential leaders. I mean, for anybody who watched Emily Thornberry's speech last week at the conference, don't tell me that's someone who couldn't be prime minister. I mean, that was an absolute stormer. And indeed, I thought that the leader speech, actually, and I'd demur, Frances, I think that Corbyn's public speaking in a different generation, and I think the point about television, and it's interesting that you pick up on those points, but also taking the stand. I mean, I thought that was a storming speech last week. I thought he looked very comfortable. I thought it came across very well. I'm not going to make the obvious comparison with another party because it would be invidious. You know, and our sticker stayed on the wall. But I think at the moment you're looking at someone that you can be confident will stand up and give a statesman-like speech. But at the same time, it is again about those transitions, that someone that can speak quietly to camera, you know, it's not, it is, can do the being comfortable in a crowd, but also can respond in the way that people of different generations and particularly youngsters imagine and experience things, which is in a smaller environment, which is on a screen, which is intimately, which is through social media. These are the other ways of being a good communicator or appealing. So that interested me too, but on the woman point, I think that is really important because it is a historical through line, and it's a historical through line in a place. And I think this is something else which is interesting, like with through those three points from Hardy to Attlee and then to Corbyn, is that and it kind of gets me out of bed in the morning again is. You know, you were talking about that travelling salesman with his, you know, with his smiley face and so on. I'm nothing against travelling salesmen. I mean, my father was one for a while, but he was also a bounder, so I know. but that kind of sense that we've got some intellectual capital back again. And we've got really, for so long, people say, well, where are the people who think? Where are the people who have ideas? Where are the people who understand history? And, you know, we've been talking about Attlee, and we've talked about the John Bew biography and your wonderful biography, and there's also Nick Thomas Simmons, who's written a wonderful biography of Attlee, who is, you know, who's in the shadow team, who's our shadow solicitor general, as you know, and securities, you know, shadow minister, is working with Diane Abbott, and also has written brilliant historical biographies of Bevin, you know, and of Attlee, and those are just one set of examples, but people who have some heft. And we're not starting from the year zero. It is, and then you've actually said that in that article, which, I mean, of course you wrote it yourself, you can't say, but I think that actually when you go back and read that August article,
yeah,
it really does feel like you think he's going to be there. That's how,
yeah,
I mean,
yeah,
it,
yeah.
It, it,
well,
know,
I think we knew by then he
I
was.
Think you, I, think
yeah.
you, I think you really have that sense, but I think it was also that sense that this is, you say, you know, I don't want to hear about mania. This is not a psychological
yeah.
condition.
Yeah.
There is a reason that this has
yeah,
happened,
yeah, yeah.
and there is a difference between popularity and the understanding of what people want and feel they need in populism. And you know, you
yeah.
called that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't. Sorry, I there's so much in what we're all saying. I want to interrupt, but I don't actually want to interrupt you. So,
but it was just to say, and that sense that we have that having some historical memory, particularly, you know, because and it goes back to where you started, which was saying, so, you know. Where does this come from? And that, you know, that was the point about, you know, in 94, it was just like someone switched the lights out.
Yeah. I just want to, you both quite rightly picked up my point about, sort of throwaway line of mine about neither of them are very good speakers. Actually, I agree completely with you that Jeremy Corbyn's speech was tremendous, and it was the speech of somebody you can rely on to. What I think I probably meant is that neither of them were great storming platform performers,
mm.
And there had been growingly a view that what you've got to have is somebody who can,
mm.
and you don't actually have to
no,
have that,
yeah.
and what you have to
Take
do
point, yeah.
is somebody like, and I did say Attlee had learned to do the thing he had to learn to do,
mm.
which was to be decent on radio.
Mm.
And,
yeah. As you said, like, that's the same point, isn't it?
Yeah.
yeah, about the sort of internet interview, yeah, no,
yeah.
yeah.
But,
yeah.
but, you know, can't you be scripted on radio? I mean, it was obviously, it was, I mean,
not really.
I think Attlee was generally perceived to be an incredibly minimal communicator.
He was,
yeah.
but if you listen to some of his radio stuff on during the 1945 election, it's actually understated and brilliant.
Right.
And there is one particular wonderful one where it's the point where Churchill has said, you know, socialism will fall back on some sort of Gestapo.
Very good.
Oh, yeah.
Very,
very good.
It wasn't bad, was
but,
it?
But actually, that line of Churchill's
yeah.
was a terrible mistake.
It was a terrible mistake,
yeah.
but partly it was a terrible mistake because Attlee was brilliant, because Attlee's response was not to say, you know, well, this is a dreadful thing for him to say. He said, I understood exactly, precisely what his intention was. He wanted you all to understand the difference between Winston Churchill, the great leader in wartime,
mm.
and Mr. Churchill, the party leader of the Conservatives.
Yeah.
And it was
mm.
just done so beautifully in such an understated way. And it was brilliant.
But public interpretation of people speaking is always in a context.
Mm.
And the context there was that Attlee had served loyally under Churchill
yes.
for the whole war and had actually, you know, Attlee was not a pacifist. And Attlee was people say he was patriotic. I mean, I actually think you could make a case for Jeremy Corbyn being patriotic.
Yes, you
and
could.
I'm not talking about Brexit.
Mm.
I'm talking about,
mm.
you know, I mean, I'm not quite talking about allotments and jam, but sort of
yeah.
there's
That'll
something
do.
There's something wrong with
allotments and
yeah.
jam.
I mean,
well,
if
you're
we
talking about Labour England, that's what I was saying.
Yeah, no,
yeah.
no, no. So I think Jeremy Corbyn could, but Attlee, and we know that because of the development of the independent
mm.
nuclear deterrent after the war, was nothing like Hardy. You know,
mm.
he's a Corbyn and Hardy share. This pacifism, and I think that's going to be Jeremy Corbyn's one of his big
mm.
problems, you know. And I mean, in that 2 year period after he was elected in 2015 and the election which has secured his place, you know, the number of conversations I listened to or things I heard where people saying there's no way that this man can ever be elected Prime Minister
mm.
if he's not going to press whatever it is now, the button or whatever. Now, you know, I think Jeremy has and is beginning to, and will find a way through that. But but Attlee didn't have that problem. That's my point.
Sure.
And also thinking about orators, you know, Michael Foote was a fantastic orator.
Mm.
Neil Kinnock was a fantastic orator. And it's quite tragic in a way how, because of context, that oratory has now been reduced to windbaggery in the interpretation of
yeah,
history.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, I think Neil Kinnock. His greatest claim to fame was he paved the way to Blairism. I'm not sure Michael Foote's greatest claim to fame is probably what he wrote about Hazlitt. I think Michael Foote genuinely just was in the wrong job.
Mm.
Michael was wrong about lots of things, and he was desperately wrong about Attlee. Michael Forbes Bevan is full of stuff about how, you know, the Prime Minister wasn't any good, and actually all the work was done by Nye Bevan and other. It's not true. And when I was the first issue of this book, and I wanted to talk to Michael, and he was putting me off, and I couldn't understand why he was putting me off. And then one day he rang up, and he didn't introduce himself, because he never did. Just said, just wanted to talk to you about, and you know, he would pause in all these old moments, which was a platform trick. Just wanted to talk to you about this, because what I feel is that you should not take this in any way other than. And what he was trying to say was, I don't really want to talk to you about it, because I can't stand the man, but I don't really want that to be reflected in what you write. Yeah. And that was the burden of it. He just said all this and then hung up. I didn't have a moment to say anything. But he was just wrong. He'd taken a sort of a particular feeling that at a particular moment in time he didn't quite feel that that Attlee had behaved correctly towards Harold Laski.
Yeah, yeah. But then Foote would have been the younger part of a left generation that opposed Attlee.
Yes.
And so Foote came in that tradition.
Sure.
And I mean, I think one of the things that's so complicated about the Labour Party is that there are all these, under the surface, unseen to most people, even thoughtful people, are these historic tensions and alliances.
Yeah.
You know, and I mean, if Jeremy, you know, when Jeremy became elected, I did say in that article, he'll have to make compromises and surprising alliances and all the rest of it. I said it, I had no idea what those would be. how much do you make a move towards the Blairites? Now, but what I've come to realise is that the Iraq War is the thing that divides the modern Labour Party.
Yeah.
And there, you know, there may be a way in which Alistair Campbell, who's a very tribal fellow, I mean, Blair was not of the tribe. Alistair Campbell is deeply of the tribe. And I think that's just a fascinating little footnote. But those who prosecuted the Iraq War supported it. That divide, and those who came out against it, which was definitely the campaign group and Robin Cook, that divide will never be that can't be made good. So, you know, but Jeremy, as you've said, has now taken a whole new generation of people and is forging new leaders. And the reason there are so many women among them is because a lot of the sort of senior people are in the on the back benches. Sorry. Well, I've said so much, I don't know which to re-shout.
You just said women.
Oh, I think...
Did that wake you up?
Yeah. Just to go back a bit.
Margaret,
when Jeremy was first elected, when he became, in 2015, he appointed the four great, the four great shadow, and none of them were women. And there were a lot of people on the centre-right who said, who sort of invoked feminism against him. And I remember feeling uncomfortable about that, because I think there is an article to be written about how feminism gets used as part of these more historic antagonisms. Mm-hmm. But, you know, my feeling about Jeremy is that he's always been a very pro-woman sort of politician, you know, and if you look at his voting record over 30 years, it's always been very good and he's done the right thing. But I think what's interesting now is history has moved on, and it is this kind of beached, as it were, a whole group of post-New Labour big beasts, and has brought to the fore...
Out to pasture.
They're all chairing, select committees now, which is a very important thing to do. But there's a whole new group, and including a lot of young, you know, Angela Rayner, Rebecca Long-Bailey, Emily Thornberry, who's sort of, not quite... of that younger group. So we are seeing a lot of women come forward, or Shami, who's here. And that's all very, very good. I mean, it's a completely new era now for Labour.
One of the odd things I thought about that was that some of the women who were condemning Corbyn at that time were women who had refused to take places in the shadow cabinet.
Yeah.
You know, you haven't,
I'm not
you
sure they were all asked.
I think Yvette Cooper was. I thought you were, and I thought that. And Harriet Holland was surely asked to. Was she not?
I don't know.
Sorry.
But you know, the truth was that they were not going to serve under Jeremy, and I think some of them would now. But there are some who quite clearly would love to. But you know, Jeremy, I think, probably can't reward people who tried to get rid of him when others who supported him. But it does mean it's quite a young team.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he's got a big task. You know, I mean, I think he's got a big task ahead.
Well, on that, I want to come back. Rachel, were you going to?
Yeah. No, it's fine. Go
on. Just picking up on that. If you were to look at the scale, this is talking about leadership now, actually post 45, and you're absolutely right. He'd had, you know, he had 5 years. He was deputy prime minister running the domestic economy. He was used to having his hands on the levers. So coming in 1945, presumably, he's not fazed really about the by the concept of the power of the state, the ability of the state to intervene. So you look at the scale of what he achieved. Let's say we have an election. Let's say Corbyn is PM at some point in the next 12 to 18 months. Given that we probably all agree that he understands, he sees with absolute clarity the scale of the problem and the incredibly profound depth of change that needs to happen to turn us around in the way that we did in 45 and we would say 79 with Margaret Thatcher. What does a Corbyn leadership look like? How does he do that? How does he stay true? How does he walk through those walls? How does he negotiate the 101 equivalent things that he needs to, that Attlee had to bended knee to the Americans, your feather bedding, your socialist Britons, fellow Britons, 45? What does that leadership look like, the scale of it?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure it's really that complicated.
Good. I'm so glad you're answering this question.
Because let's use your metaphor of the levers.
Mm-hmm.
Not accidentally reminds us of trains, which will be very useful to be renationalised. I was on the trains in France last week, and I realised that even when other people have national economies that are in huge trouble, things can actually be made to work if your priorities are in the right place, even if other things are a mess. But on that question of levers, for me, and of course, you know, that it is all in the manifesto. I mean, those key to directly answer your question, Deborah, the key elements are in the manifesto for me. And that question of what levers do you pull? And of course, again, I think Francis, you did use the word visionary, but that visionary 45 manifesto as well, which says within the first three paragraphs, this is a socialist manifesto. Mm-hmm. Nothing quite so strong from the
absolutely.
Most recent manifesto, let us remind ourselves, although some would say otherwise. But anyway, but I think the question comes back to also some of the points that Melissa was making in terms of that absolute consistency of values. And the point that you made, Francis, about the analogy, whatever the other differences are, is here is somebody who knows what he thinks and is there to achieve something which is not about being himself. And actually, those levers are quite clear in terms of the challenge. The scale of the challenge is as big as is, because the relationship between capital and the markets has completely broken down in relation to people and the state. Now, you can call it the neoliberal project, you can call it whatever you like, but we basically understand what that means. So when you say, well, we have to look seriously again at what is required to do those things, just to take one example, I mean, we can go through them, but just to take the one example, one of those big levers, which is right up front to pull, is we would like people to pay their taxes. Right? We would like these big international corporate conglomerates who are working here and extracting value and not putting anything back to do some really basic stuff. We would like the city to pay its money and we would like the big global. I mean, even at that level, you're talking very profoundly about rebuilding the relationship on which the basic idea of a kind of bourgeois liberal democracy that you know, that labor and work can work together with business and capital, because that has fundamentally broken down. And so when I had to have a laugh. I mean, I can't even remember who it was, but somebody was like, oh, there's going to be a flight of capital. I'm like, oh, really? Did you not notice what has happened in the last 20 years? The flight of capital already happened.
Yes, yeah.
I think it was Nick Cohen saying, the flight of capital from Britain. And I'm like, okay, come, I want to show you all the, it, like, it, that's already happened. and also the money that is here and is not paying for itself. So I think that the scale, you know, when the scale is on that side, and I, as I say, it's like, you know, sometimes it's just there are a couple of really big levers that you need to reposition in the right place in terms of the logic of economics and society and having it based on a moral value. You were talking about the nuclear question, well, or the war question. I think about it, I don't know the answer. But what I do know, Minister, is that when I wake up and I hear that, you know, that the American president is threatening North Korea again, I also then do think, well, what is the conversation? You know, a Jeremy Corbyn in conversation with Angela Merkel in conversation, you know, that federation in relation to that then repositions itself in the context of the global argument. When I say it's not that complicated, well, it wasn't that complicated when, I mean, you were talking about pacifism and stuff like that. Sylvia Pankhurst was a lifelong pacifist. In fact, she was standing next to Tom Attlee, who, of course, was Attlee's conchy brother, some of you may have known. Really, really, absolutely, I mean, brave, brave man. And he was speaking at the docks in Poplar, and Sylvia Pankhurst was sitting next to him. And some thugs came along and said, "We're going to throw that suffragette in the river," you know, whatever it was, and it knew it very well. But when it came to with Sylvia Pankhurst, she noticed Mussolini very early on. But when it came to fascism, when it came to the rise of fascism, Mussolini, and then Hitler, she's like, "No, can't do this anymore." It's like, I understand the need. And I think that it's precisely because the scale of where we are, to me, is this point in history. It's really at that level that it's kind of, we know what's wrong and right, and now we have to, and then you make the adjustments that make that difference. Anyway, I'm going on.
No, it's interesting, and I'm so glad I don't have to answer the question, because I think it's going to be really complicated. And I don't disagree with anything you say, but I, you know, what's that phrase, events, dear boy, events, which we should call events. You know, my understanding of politics is very facile to say, it's just about the exercise of fine judgment at points of incredible, you know, pressure. And that, you know, I don't know if any of you have read Blair's diaries or Alistair Campbell's diaries. I'm a diary fanatic, so I've read all of them. And what's so interesting there is you just see, it's probably one of the first insights into actually what it's like to be in government, but from a completely different point of view. One thing you notice is they all only sleep 2 hours a night, and I'm absolutely sure if they'd have read that new book about the science of sleep, they wouldn't be in Iraq now. There's just something definitely gone wrong there.
He makes the point that it's called Why We Sleep, it's called, isn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
And he said, and it's this whole thing, and he makes the point and says that Ronald Reagan and Margaret Thatcher made like a big thing about the fact they only needed to sleep for 4 hours a night. Well, that worked out really well.
Yeah, no, it did. Well, I mean, Campbell and Blair slept too. I mean, Blair, often Alistair Campbell said, you know, went to sleep at 4, got up at 6. I mean, you can't, anyway, that's a point. I just think it is going to be very complicated because, I mean, governments, it's, you know, if another obvious point. In a way, what we've got now is we've got a sort of opposition, not an agitational opposition, but if you look at the 2017 campaign, Corbyn was going around the country, he was, you know, he did a fantastic job. Government is a different kind of job. There's going to be disappointments, there's going to be things you can't do. I suspect, though, I'm sure, that John McDonnell in particular, as Shadow Chancellor, has thought about these things and what they're able to do. And I'm also absolutely convinced, and here I'm with you, that they will not go down the Kinnock, Blair, Miliband sort of trimming route. Mm. They will probably, my guess is, decide on priorities and stick with those. And because I also more or less agree with what Rachel says, I don't think it is quite a crisis. It's not quite, it's obviously not like the Second World War. I think the crisis arising in the last 10 years and the crisis, you know, given a terrible twist by austerity, has brought us to a point where things have to change. And you only have to look at the Conservative Party conference to see they were all talking about the things that Jeremy Corbyn talks about. They were all, you know, it was amazing to see, what's that guy, Sajid?
All
Javid.
Three of them?
Yeah, all three what?
All three people at the Tory Party conference.
But they, you know, talking about housing, they were talking about youth. They were, you know, so he has changed the terms of the debate. And so it's really, how do we, what does government need to do? My fear is the Tories have their best skill is at holding on to power. It seems that even that's slipping now. So I really, as I'm sure we all do, passionately hope that a Corbyn government gets the chance to make those changes. And, you know, I think there'll be lots of questions. So if you're going to get rid of tuition fees, which was a promise that at the time people said absolutely crazy, within 3 months you have Lord Adonis saying great idea. I mean, it's interesting, this changing of the political weather. Mm. And, you know, I remember my dad always used to say in politics there's the weathercocks and the signposts. And, you know, it was a bit simple, but, you know, the people who just say this is what we should do and the people who say, oh, we do that. Oh, actually, the wind's going. Let's do that. You know, and definitely Corbyn and McDonnell are signposts. But they'll have lots of choices to make. And, you know, what will it be like for Jeremy Corbyn when there's a demonstration against him by, you know, sort of workers who, you know, public sector pay cut? I mean, these are things you just have to think about. Yes. This is politics. My view is, and this is where I think Thatcher was good at it in her own strange way, what you do as a leader, and I think Ed Miliband was very, very good at this, probably better than all the rest of it, is you have to keep up a dialogue with the nation about what you're doing and why. And Theresa May is rubbish at it because she doesn't know how to speak to people. And she's a brilliant administrator, I'm sure, and all. So I think if I were Jeremy Corbyn, I'd be thinking about how I would, and I'm sure there are mechanisms for doing it, the equivalent of the old sort of broadcast to the nation, a bit like the Queen, you know. But you go on and you say, this is where we've got, this is our priority. It is quite a good idea, actually. Yeah, it's my
cup
idea.
Cup of tea with Jeremy.
I'm interested in what you say about sleep. Macmillan understood this. Macmillan read lots and lots of novels while he was Prime Minister. And when Thatcher was Prime Minister, and he watched her for a while, and one day he said, I wish she'd read a book.
But that was partly, you just wish she'd have a bit of a soul. It's not just about time, it's just like being a human being.
Well, I see it's partly also that she was thinking about absolutely nothing, but cause she was a top-class administrator.
Yeah.
I don't think Theresa May is, by the way. You said you thought she probably...
She's an apparatchik or something, but she's not a communicator.
But Thatcher was a top-class administrator. She knew how to pull the levers, which lever to pull when. I just want to add one thing to what everybody's saying, which is its priorities. The Attlee government made a revolution by doing very few things, but the few things that matter.
Mm.
There was nationalisation, there was the NHS,
yeah.
There was the implementation of the 1944 Education Act.
Yeah.
There was Cradle to the Grave, so it's Social Security. That's the four, really.
Yeah.
Nothing else. And you've got to, you, Melissa, are going to go and say, what about comprehensive education? And I'm going to be right behind you, because as you know, we work together on this. I'm going to be there too, saying, you know, come on, you've got to do something about the wretched mess they've made of the education system, the academies and all of that. You've got to go back to Crosland and the comprehensive ideal, and you're going to be saying that to them. And I will be with you, but if they say no, then I think you and I are going to have to say, okay, it's the language of priorities.
Not in public, Francis. We'll not be saying that in public. can I just say, I think one thing that, if I were Jeremy Corbyn now, I think there's two challenges for a party at this stage in opposition where, you know, first of all, you do not think it's one more heave, because it's definitely not. I think they should be working, and if I ever get a chance when I've seen them, say, detailed, you make your priorities, so that's the big picture. You then have a really detailed view of how you're going to do it. And then the third thing is, you create, as it were, popular-facing arguments. And here you learn from Blair. The 1997 election, there were five pledges, I think, on that little card. And Pete, and that's, again, your point about 45, where we can learn from previous leaders. You say, this is going to be our priority, but it can't just be a wish. It's got to be, there's got to be a whole hinterland, or like an iceberg, where you've done all the technical work. I mean, government will always change quite how it works out, but there's a lot of work that needs to be done now. And I really am hoping and working myself towards, in particularly in an area I care about, getting them to do, you know, what do you do with the academies?
Yeah.
I mean, they're legally embedded.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, you know, maybe what you, there's so many things.
They were designed to be difficult to unpick.
Yeah. Yeah.
And they really well designed.
And I think I know Jeremy's team understand all that, but there's an element. Opposition is without resource. Government has a lot of resource. Mm-hmm. And so, but I think those 600,000 members have brought them more income, which actually gives you more resource.
I think we might have maybe 10 minutes for questions, if and then any or thoughts or comments or. Yes, yes.
Or march on Parliament.
That's another idea. just one quick point that I'd like your thoughts on. Francis has repeatedly talked about Labour England, and I'm assuming that's deliberately not Labour Britain. The relationship of these leaders with Scotland and Wales, particularly Ireland and Northern Ireland, can you say a little bit about, because obviously it matters more now, perhaps, with what's happened in Scotland than it did in the past.
Why don't you take a group of questions while
we think
about that
one? Yes, this lady, who's the one? Yes.
Yeah. Mine was comparing the pledges. Melissa, those five pledges that Blair had back in 1997, they were really tiny little pledges that were committing the party to something that we knew they could definitely carry out and to gain the trust of the electorate, but they were tiny. The five that Francis just mentioned are absolutely massive pledges, absolutely massive. And I mean, saving the NHS, for instance.
Yeah. But I'm talking about clarity, not content. I just mean, so the electorate, you know, most of the electorate are not steeped in all these things. So you would say, what will a Corbyn government do? It'll do, you know, build millions of homes. So it's like, you know, I can't remember the five pledges of Blairism, but I'm sure you're right. They were very, you know, we will be nice to everyone.
One was to stick within the Tories commitment.
Easy.
Do we have one more question? Yes.
Yeah.
Hardy working class.
Yeah.
Attlee working class.
No.
Corbyn working class.
No.
What is working class?
Well,
no,
do you mean? Well, it depends what you mean by working class. But Attlee came from an upper middle class family. His father was a.
I wasn't mentioning them in that their names in the context of where they came from, but what their philosophy was in terms of what socialism was and what working class means. Not to them personally.
Do you understand the question?
You mean what it meant in terms of their electorates and the people they represented rather than themselves?
Simply put, what is working class today?
Oh, well,
Who's Corbyn appealing to?
One of the major working classes of today, if you want to be put in politically relative terms, if we're going to say there was Attlee then and then there was Keir Hardie then, is women. Women as workers and women in the workforce. And that is a very important working women. And that doesn't mean class, and it never did. It's been one of the key tensions within feminism and the left forever and a day. But the concept of women as a class in themselves, as more than half of a fair size, more than half of the electorate, and now then more of the half of the trade union movement, and thus very much part of who the lower W working classes are, but across class. How the women in the electorate, whether it's in the trade union movement, whether it's in business, whether it's across, the idea of the working class as women is a very, very important modern constituency, and one that Keir Hardie would have understood very well. And Keir Hardie understood how that somebody who was who came from a suburban background, well, didn't really exist then, but you know, that an aristocratic woman, a Mrs. Ramsay MacDonald. Or a working class woman in the textile industry women formed a class in themselves too, and that's something that Keir Hardie would recognise as a really important constituency. So I'm just going to put one bid in for that.
Yeah. I don't know much about Attlee's feminism. Can I answer that question? I think one of the really interesting things about Jeremy Corbyn's constituency is thinking back to Labour claims for years for full employment. The thing about employment now is people are working, but they're not able to live by working. And I think that's one of the things that Jeremy put, you know, that the left have understood. that you can be working in, you know, the gig economy, zero contract, but you cannot afford to live. And that's something the Tories don't understand. But so that goes back to my original point that every leader, what they try to do and who they appeal to is shaped by the economy in which they find themselves. And we are now in a completely different sort of economy. I'm very aware we haven't mentioned Brexit, actually, which may be why everyone's looking fairly cheerful. The question about Scotland,
yes.
Wales, and
the Union.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Labour England thing probably refers to manner, you know, or what that used to be called Blue Labour, this idea of Labour understanding something essentially English. I'm ashamed to say I don't know in detail Jeremy Corbyn's approach to the United Kingdom. My guess is it is for, not for Scottish independence, well, I know it isn't, wanting to keep, you know, they'll keep that working class, historic working class or progressive connection with Scotland and Wales and Northern Ireland, but probably further devolved. And
No, I didn't. I wanted to dodge the question about Scotland and Northern Ireland just a little tiny bit, because when I talk about Labour England, I know very clearly what I mean. And what I would mean by it in Scotland doesn't differ that much, but it does differ. Unfortunately, I don't know the ways in which it differs. So I'm not exactly dodging the question. I'm just not answering it.
Okay.
That's why you're not a politician.
Exactly.
Can I say one thing about Jeremy?
Yeah.
I noticed the other day he was on, he was about to go on the Andrew Marr programme, and somebody else was interviewing him before, and this young, enthusiastic reporter, he was sitting in the canteen flicking through a newspaper, and she went, "Oh, so tell me, you're about to go on the most important political interview of the year. Did you sleep last night? You know, is you very tense?" And I just thought he was absolutely amazing. He went, "No, last night I did what I always did. I went home, had something to eat, had a cup of tea and watched Casualty." And she went, "Oh," and he said, "What do you think of, you know, it was really interesting last night, the Casualty thing." And first of all, I believed him. You know, when it was like Gordon Brown said, "I listened to the Arctic Monkeys," you know, you just saw the PR, the sort of Francis Beckett of the. I actually believe Jeremy Corbyn does go home and have a cup of tea and watch Casualty and probably get a good night's sleep. And in some way, I think that's sort of that's kind of Labour England, you know, in all sorts of ways.
There was something about Attlee always sleeping, wasn't there?
It's all about sleep.
He didn't churn things over.
With Attlee, it was more a function of Attlee had a decision-making process, and perhaps Jeremy has too. I suspect he may have a decision-making process like a steel trap. He took a decision and didn't think about it, and it was gone. And he always claimed to sleep well at night, whatever he'd done. He didn't talk about his troubles to anybody. Pretty well every other, most frustrating person to write a book about, because every other leading politician you have, you know, there's a diary somewhere, or someone they unburdened themselves. He never seems to unburden himself.
I've got that problem with Sylvia as well.
Really?
Yeah.
She didn't either.
Yeah, it's just...
So what do they have in common then?
So, I will come back to that. What he did was... He didn't even he never unburdened himself, never talked politics to his wife or to his family or at home. His children all told me, no, he never came home, never did. If he brought any politics home, he'd bring little anecdotes, funny things that had happened. And so they all remembered this little anecdote about how there was a Labour MP called Neil McLean, and they claimed that Neil McLean had been showing some Americans around the House of Commons, and a colleague who'd wanted to speak to him shouted across the corridor, "Kneel," and all the Americans knelt down. And I said, but I heard that story about Neil Kinnock. You heard it told about Neil Kinnock. I heard that story told about Neil Kinnock. And what I realised, of course, is that that story probably never, ever happened, but has been told about every member of Parliament called Neil for the last 150 years or so. So I'm pretty sure that's what must be. But that was the level of the politics that Attlee took home. He was like a... he would get the train to even when he was prime minister, he would get the bus, he would get on the train to Great Missenden, and he would get home and he would be immersed in his family, and he didn't. And who was it? I think it was Barbara Castle. I think it was Barbara Castle. I certainly interviewed Barbara Castle for this book, who said, well, that's probably right, you know, because when you go home, you don't want somebody saying, well, what about Section 2 of the Education Bill?
Hardy had a great separation between his home life and his political life, but it was partly exaggerated by the fact that his family were in Scotland and he was living in London and carrying on his parliamentary business. But he also never talked about his feelings. But that's not a problem with politicians, is it? That's a bigger problem. I wonder if not talking about politics at home is a good or a bad thing. I've no idea.
Would you?
Yes.
How would you?
More questions, yeah.
I want to ask, I'm going back to your question about the working class. Now, I think Jeremy Corbyn and especially MacDonald,
John MacDonald.
They are for the working class and of the working class. And they
Jeremy isn't.
They will appeal to the working class. My criticism now is that people are afraid to say that they are working class. When people are in a lecture hall or whatever, they never say the workers. They always, what's the word they use instead of?
Working people.
Hard working, decent, law-abiding people.
And their families.
I must tell you this. It's very important that I thought you've cut right across me. I met a woman on a march that I was doing, and we were all sitting talking afterwards. I said, oh, what do you do for a living then? I'm an academia. And I thought, no. I said, well, you're a teacher. She said, no, I work in academia. Now, I think that's very, very snobbish. So I said, but you are of the working class. Now, I would address people, a teacher, a lecturer, a doctor, you are of the working class. We mustn't be afraid to say working class.
I've got an answer, but I think we're taking another question. Yeah.
Well, I did, bring it up to current day, I did want to ask the question you just alluded to, which is about Brexit. To what extent do you actually think it really is a done deal?
Not at
given
all.
When
how long have we got?
Session at three.
Well, I'm just aware that it's on 38 degrees petitions that go around the internet, and you know, one madly signs and whatever. So I mean, there's a lot of pressure on it in that respect. But I would really welcome your views, really, each of you, on where we think we are, what the practical hope is for the future in that respect. Please.
Well, can I just mention what the lady said there first?
Yeah, sure.
I think, well, my view is that the economy is so fractured that it's a different sort of, there's different kinds of working class now. But if there is any leader who would speak in that way that you appreciate, Jeremy, you know, Jeremy is immersed in that politics in a way that Blair and Brown and Ed Miliband were not. So, I mean, I'm sure that's why you're a supporter of his. So, I think now maybe political rhetoric and narrative is about talking about different sectors and talking about the gendered nature of work and so on. So I do think the language has changed, but that if anybody will get to the touchstone of injustice of the relationship between capital and labour, it will be Jeremy. Brexit, the only thing I'd say, two things. Nick Clegg this morning, I noticed, who is now rediscovering himself as a campaigner after having screwed up our country with David Cameron, has suggested everybody should flood the two main parties and make sure that when the vote comes in 2018, MPs vote against the deal, whatever the deal is done. So there's a huge movement to reverse it. The other thing I would say, and I'm really not I've, this has always been a difficulty for me. You know, the reason that that shadow cabinet revolt began against Jeremy Corbyn, it all was about his, what they saw as his passivity in the face of Brexit, because the agreed progressive view was that staying in Europe was the way forward for the progressive left. And what was obvious to me is that Jeremy is a historic Lexiteer, you know, who believes in socialism in one country. And that was why he was, I think, admittedly very passive in the face of the campaign. But if he, if actually the, that doesn't really take us anywhere except to make one observation. Jeremy Corbyn would not be in the position he's in now if the Brexit vote hadn't happened, because Cameron would have stayed. His position would have been shored up. We wouldn't have had the disaster we've had now. So, and also, Jeremy benefits from Brexit because it's easier without certain, I mean, his view would be Europe is a capitalist club and you can do more without being tied to Europe. So, but having said that, Labour is clearly shifting on the single market, and I haven't kept up with the latest, but there's a definite shift of position. So it's, I mean, this is, these are really, really fluid times, because I think Labour needs to be identified with the progressive idea of no borders and Europe, but that its leaders are not really sympathetic to the European project. So I think there's problems ahead for Labour in that regard. That doesn't really, doesn't help you, but I'm just setting out what I see.
It's interesting what you say is true. That was very much true in the 70s when the first vote happened. Anybody else?
Well, I just put two very brief remarks, and mostly because I don't have very much to add to what Melissa put very eloquently there, but I think there are two things. When you say it's a done deal, if you mean that vote happened and it stands, yes, we're not Catalonia, and the nature, you know, for... For better or for worse, what is it? You know, the leader represents the party. That is the nature of the organisation that we're in, and the party is made up of people who take a very, very, very different positions on this. And with so in terms of that, this idea of turning back the clock and revocation. I mean, if that's what you mean by is it a done deal? This has happened, and we go forward with it. Secondly, and because that's democracy, it's hard, but it is. And I think also this idea to be lectured in progressive values by people who've lived a life to be very happy, to see a lot of people left behind and not sharing in the bounty, and I don't want to use the big E elites word, but seriously to be lectured by people on. And suddenly there's closed-mindedness of the hinterland of apparently the entirety of the rest of Britain outside of London, and that in itself a very small part. It's not acceptable. I mean, this is about broad bases and democracies. Something's broken. We have to address. You know, there were really good reasons why people felt left out. The second part of it is a really important one, and Melissa has so rightly emphasised the economy. That point about the Capitalist Club of Europe and so on. If you want to feel confident about the Labour government that's coming, all of that actually works very well with the bits of capitalism that are still functional, and would like to be. And I think that is also, that's a point that doesn't seem to be made. I mean, I don't know whether I'm missing it somewhere, but it doesn't. I mean, the FT probably get it, but it doesn't seem to be, the potential for good working relationships and imaginative and creative ones in a way that the Tories don't even seem to be addressing is actually, you know, it's an unimagined, it's your thing about imaginative alliances, not only within the party, but between money and business and government.
Yeah, but also, I mean, what Larry Elliott of The Guardian, who's very good, made the point that Brexit has revealed the fundamental long-standing weakness of the British economy. And it was that we, this is New Labour to a T, it was all about finance capital, not about investment in things and manufacturing. And I mean, one of the priorities, I'm sure, is of John McDonnell and Jeremy Corbyn is to get us making things again and to be a functional economy. Yes. And Brexit will permit that. And I think I'm right in saying that the Parliament will incorporate all the progressive parts of European law into our legislation. We all know more about this, shall we? But, you know, I don't think we'll let go of the good things about progressive European law. I don't think there's a lot of Tories who want to do that.
I just want to say very briefly, I don't agree with any of this. Mm-hmm. I think the thought behind Marilyn's question. Mm-hmm. If what we end up with looks roughly like what we were promised during the referendum campaign, then you are right. That's democracy. It's difficult, but that's how it is, and that's how it has to be. But if it doesn't look anything like what we were led to expect, and it looks as though it's not going to look anything like it, then the moral case for a second referendum would seem to me to be unanswerable. Now, I think that that's what Keir Starmer thinks. I can't say that because he doesn't say it, because he obviously can't say it. But I have listened to Keir Starmer, and he was at the lunch, and I was listening to him very carefully, and I thought, I like what you say, but have you got the leader on board?
Yeah.
And he said, he paused for a bit, and he said, well, you know, everything I've said to you today, I've said to Jeremy, and he doesn't disagree with it. There is clearly going to be, I mean, I hope Keir Starmer remains in charge of this. He's somebody I have a lot of time for, and I think, you know, if you think some really important negotiations are going to happen, would you rather have Keir Starmer do it, or would you rather have David Davis doing it? Well, you don't have to be a Labour Party member to know which you prefer. So I'll wrap this up. I think that that in the sense in which I think you meant the question, no, I don't think it's a done.
I would just. But can I say, so this is a sentence. I think Brexit was as much a vote on austerity as it was
of course.
On Europe. And Jeremy tapped into that. And that's.
And just, I think something in the way that, I suppose, yes, we do indirectly have David Cameron to thank for Jeremy Corbyn. We have Theresa May's snap election to thank for giving us, the wider public, the moment to allow Jeremy Corbyn to come through. And in 6 weeks, Jeremy Corbyn made good 2 years of vitriol and nastiness, and who knows, had he had another couple of weeks in the election. And I personally feel the same way about Brexit. The referendum was not a discussion. It was, we failed to tell an emotional story, a narrative, as they say. The other side had that emotional, we'll get our country back. And I think while we slide now, in effect, we've got a sort of slow motion referendum discussion going on. Mm-hmm. And we have Gina Miller and lots of people to thank for keeping that, you know what, let's just keep thinking about this. And it could well be that the waiting game of seeing how events play out or don't play out could mean that we do get to a point in another 6, 12 months or 18 months or more where people may be Brexiteers, many Brexiteers may be wanting a second opportunity. I just think what Corbyn pulled off in 6 weeks, had she not delivered us that opportunity with the snap election, we would never know what Corbyn was made of. Would we really? That whole period?
We'd never know what the opportunity was.
That's right, that's yes.
We'd never know. It's not just Corbyn. It's, as I was saying, what I was saying yesterday, it's a mixture of the time and the person. If you can have the time, and if you don't have the person, then it's useless. You can have the person, but if the time's wrong, it's useless.
Chair, we do need a break before 3 o'clock.
You're very good. this is
thank you, comrade.
We will continue. I think our next session we can start at 3:15. There's no problem. It's lovely, easy, easy. I want to just ask each of our panelists. We do have a 1945 moment coming, don't we? Do we feel we have a 1945 moment coming with the next election?
I'd love to be able to say an out straightforward yes. I think we have a 1945-ish moment coming.
Okay.
That's an English answer.
Rachel.
Yes.
Your answers.
Maybe.
Possibly.
Maybe.
Ish, yes, mate.
Thank you so much. Melissa, Rachel, bye.